Managers often want to know what return on investment they can expect if they do put some effort and money into improving how their projects handle their requirements. It's hard to predict the precise return on investment any organization can get from this, though. In fact, let me tell you how to get a zero return on investment. You spend time and money creating new processes and procedures and templates and training your staff, but no one actually changes how they approach requirements on the project. Not only does this yield no return on the investment you've made, but it also means that the next project is likely to go no better than the last project because nothing really changed. However, I can give you a thought process to go through when you're contemplating what kind of ROI to expect in your organization. To think through a potential ROI calculation, you need to consider the kinds of investments you're making, which are shown in the left column on this slide, and the possible benefits, as shown in the right column. Your investment in process improvement typically begins with some kind of assessment of your current requirements engineering practices. This assessment looks at what you do today that works well for you and also the things you do that cause pain, such as rework, wasted time, overworked developers, and unsatisfied customers. Next, you might choose to develop some processes that you think will give your teams better results. Perhaps you create templates for some of these key requirements documents I've mentioned, such as the vision and scope document and the software requirements specification. You might send your requirements analysts and other team members to get trained in what software requirements is all about and how to do the analyst job. I always recommend that you train not just the analysts, but also software developers, testers, project managers, user representatives, marketing staff, and any other key players on the team, because requirements touch all project stakeholders. Maybe you buy your team members some books on requirements engineering. I always marvel that so many business analysts are trying to do the job without ever having been trained in requirements engineering and without having at least one good contemporary book on software requirements on their desk. It's just not reasonable to expect people to do a good job on something as complex and difficult as requirements engineering without being properly prepared. Many organizations find it helpful to bring in a consultant to help them begin to apply new requirements practices in an effective and efficient way. You might decide to buy a requirements management tool, a database in which to store your requirements. But most of your investment is really in the time your team members spend gathering, analyzing, documenting, and reviewing requirements and managing those requirements throughout the life cycle of the project. This investment can yield many benefits. You should have far fewer defects in the requirement specifications when they are delivered to the development team. This should reduce the time the developers will have to spend reworking their products to cope with corrected and added requirements. You'll also implement fewer product features that seemed like a good idea, but which really don't get used. When I was a developer, I always found this very frustrating. A user would swear he needed certain functionality implemented right away, so I would build it, but no one ever used it. By implementing the right functionality at the right time, you deliver the maximum value to the customers based on the resources invested in building the product. Doing a good job on requirements elicitation also reduces the cost of adding unplanned enhancements, as customers keep discovering requirements that we might have known about earlier if we had asked the right questions of the right people. The result of all these benefits is to accelerate the software development process. High-quality requirements also reduce the number of miscommunications that take place among the project stakeholders. Doing a better job of requirements elicitation and scope management reduces the extent of scope creep. A less tangible outcome is that better requirements and a better requirements process can reduce the overall level of chaos on the project. And if all goes well, you get a very tangible benefit from your improved requirements approaches: higher customer satisfaction, which also translates into higher team member satisfaction. Now, many of these benefits are hard to quantify. I don't know exactly how much it saves you to reduce the miscommunications on a project by, say, 40%. If you want to quantify your return on investment, you need some baseline data. For example, you need to know how much you spend, on average, to fix a customer-reported defect that you can trace back to an incorrect or missing requirement. Without such data, you can't possibly quantify the ROI. However, even subjective or anecdotal experiences can reveal the benefits of improved requirements practices. The ROI only has to be above 1.0 to make it worthwhile. I can't predict what return on investment your organization will receive from making changes in your requirements engineering practices. However, answering questions like the ones shown on this slide will help you judge to what extent requirements issues are causing problems on your projects, and therefore how much benefit you might gain from addressing those requirements issues. It's a good idea to know what fraction of your software development cost and effort is devoted to rework, doing over something that you thought was already done. Most software organizations don't measure their rework level, but the ones who do get very scary results. It's not unusual to find that between 40 and 60% of your total development effort is rework. Every time you add an unexpected requirement, or rewrite some code because of a corrected or modified requirement, or retest the software because you had to add some new functionality, that's rework. I think every software organization ought to know, on average, how much it costs you to deal with a customer-reported defect. You should know, on average, how much it costs you to deal with a defect discovered during system testing. This kind of data lets you know where the leverage is to make your software development and maintenance processes more efficient. You might discover, as some other organizations have, that shifting a fraction of your planned testing resources into early inspection of requirements documents pays off in a big way. Of the defects that users report or that are discovered during system testing, how many of those can you trace back to requirements problems? Again, this will show you where you have a high leverage opportunity to reduce the cost of dealing with problems by detecting them early on. Perhaps you'll learn that very few of your errors originate in the requirements, which would mean that improving your requirements doesn't give you a lot of leverage for reducing your cost of dealing with defects. Without the data, you have no way of knowing for sure. You might also want to know how much of the maintenance effort your organization expends is because of requirements that were overlooked during requirements development. Thinking through all these factors might give you an idea of how much your project teams could shorten their delivery schedules by reducing the number of errors in their requirements. Process improvement is all about understanding how you work today so you can think of better ways to work tomorrow.